Welcome to Talks at GS. I'm very delighted to introduce three amazing professionals. Dr. Giovanni Caforio is the CEO of Bristol Myers. Dr. Jill O'Donnell Tormey is the CEO and Director of Scientific Affairs of the Cancer Research Institute. And Dr. Lori Glimcher, the Dean of the Weill Cornell Medical College in New York City, where she is also a professor of medicine. We're going to start first with a little science lesson. Jill, I want you to walk us through. We should have a slide up here. Okay.
All right, so I think it's to just describe what is immunotherapy. So immunotherapy, in very basic terms, is treatments that harness the innate power of your own immune system. Traditional drugs, like chemotherapies or even radiation, directly attack the cancer. Immunotherapies are different in that they don't treat the cancer directly. Instead, they are treating the patient. So it's drugs that are actually enabling your immune system to do what it should do. We know that all cells have markers on their surface. And the immune system knows if it's a normal cell that it ignores it. But a cancerous cell has mutations. And with mutations, they develop new markers on their cell that are different from normal cells. These are recognized by the immune system, and they signal the immune system to attack. Unfortunately, sometimes the immune system does not do its job because the cancer cell has co-opted mechanisms to shut the immune system off. So it tells it not to attack, doesn't attack, and the cancer cells continue to spread. And the hope is with more combination immunotherapies, we can what was called raise the tail of the curve so that we get a higher percentage of patients that respond. So I think that's a good enough introduction
for
right
now. So Lori, where does immuno-oncology fit with the cornerstones of cancer therapy? So we started with surgery, then that led to advances in chemotherapy, radiation therapy, then targeted therapies, now immuno-oncology.
Well, let me say first that this is an extraordinary, extraordinary time for cancer and immunology because the two have finally merged. Let me also say that there are some tumors that can be cured by chemotherapy and radiation therapy, and those are usually tumors that are detected before they have spread. Once a tumor has spread, or so-called metastasized, it is much, much more difficult to treat, and it can't be treated simply by surgical removal. Chemotherapy treatment can reduce the size of the tumor, and in some instances can prevent a tumor from recurring, but there are many, many failures. And so I would make two points. One is that cancer is not just one disease. Everybody has a unique cancer, and in some instances, that will mean chemotherapy and surgery. In other instances, it will mean identifying a drug that targets a specific genetic mutation in that tumor. Okay, so you're attacking the tumor. But in many cases, that also is not sufficient, and the tumor will grow back. What is always there is your basic immune surveillance mechanism, your immune system that's present in all of your organs, whose only function is to recognize foreign pathogens in your body. And sometimes those can be bacteria or viruses, and sometimes they can be tumor cells, because tumor cells, as Jill pointed out, display these markers on their surface that should alert your immune system to kill them, but it doesn't always work. And in the setting of cancer, unfortunately, those inhibitory receptors dominate. The key discovery was that we needed to block those inhibitory receptors. And so the T cell becomes activated when you give those checkpoint blockers, as they're called, becomes activated and kills the tumor cell. So that's the basic biology. But to your earlier original question, I think we need to tailor therapy for each patient because each patient's tumor is unique. And I think more and more we're going to be turning to immunotherapy to do that, because chemotherapy is like a hammer hitting a fly. Mm-hmm. It destroys cancer cells, but it also destroys normal cells, leading to undesirable consequences. Immunotherapy is guided It is guided, it's much less toxic, and it just activates your own body's system to kill off that tumor.
Giovanni, the new checkpoint inhibitors on the market, describe some of the results that you have seen with these drugs. And second, do you envision a scenario where chemotherapy is completely eliminated?
Yeah, Jamie, so let me say the first trials that were conducted in melanoma, because there was always a perspective that melanoma would be, because of scientific reasons, a tumor that would respond to that approach. And a lot of the early research really happened in melanoma. And so today we see over 60% of patients responding, 20%, approximately 17% of patients have a total response, meaning they no longer have any signs of active disease, and 60 to 70% of patients are alive after 1 year. So major progress in just 5 or 6 years. In a cancer type like melanoma, where the efficacy of these agents, particularly in combination, has been so remarkable, chemotherapy is basically not used anymore. The second field was lung cancer, and there we have seen physicians very rapidly adopt those agents, with 80, 90% of patients today receiving immuno-oncology agents, and the use of chemotherapy has virtually disappeared. And that's because the response rate and survivals have doubled over what was available before. When you actually go into newly diagnosed patients right after a diagnosis, actually combination chemotherapy in some patients works. And so as we go into earlier and earlier lines of therapy, into more tumors, it is likely that some patients may continue to benefit from chemotherapy. So as this field develops, going back to what Lori had said, we will be able to personalize the approach to the treatment of any patient, and there will be continue to be a role for multiple modalities. But clearly, immuno-oncology is emerging as a leading modality.
Jill, we've seen in still a large number of patients that they don't respond to immunotherapies. Why do you think that is? Why are we seeing non-responders?
Well, I think, you know, cancer and the immune system are both two very complicated systems. To get an immune response against cancer, you have to first activate the immune cell, the T cell, so that it can recognize that the cancer is there and it's different from a normal cell and it needs to be destroyed. That T cell then needs to come out of the lymph node, circulate through the body, get to the tumor, and interact with the tumor. So it has to happen there. And then tumors are very wily. They're dynamic too. They have actually co-opted some of the systems that the immune system naturally uses to shut itself off, because otherwise you can develop autoimmunity and inflammation. So we have natural checks and balances in the immune system. Well, tumor cells have co-opted that same mechanism and actually use it to shut off the T cell even when it's there. So you can see there's multiple steps to get a successful immune response against cancer.
From my perspective, I'll just echo what's been said. I think this is the beginning of a really exciting journey. And I think that the progress we're making is extraordinary. It requires everybody to be working together, and it will be probably a long journey, but I believe it is going in the right direction.
Well, I just want to say thank you all so very much, and what a pleasure it is to have three people who are at the forefront of such an exciting field of medicine. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jamie. Thank you.